Welcome to the Monday MMA show. McGregor Forever has just dropped, and if you're a massive Conor McGregor fan like I am, then we've been waiting for this for a long time. I mean, I'm just going to start off by saying Conor McGregor, what an incredible icon for the sport. If it wasn't for him, and I'm sure I can say this for about a million other people, I would not be a UFC fan today. He captivated me, you know, seeing him speak about how he was going to be a multimillionaire, a car for every day of the week, multiple UFC world champion, saying all these things into existence when he was broke, taking social welfare from the Irish government, living in his mum and dad's house. If that doesn't inspire you to go out and get something, then I don't know what will. He's had an amazing career, man. I know a lot of people are very quick to judge him for his actions over the last few years, but I always say, mate, try and be in his shoes. There is no way any normal person would act in a sane way if you were in his shoes. He literally went, like I said, from being social welfare to fighting Floyd Mayweather about 4 or 5 years for $100 million. That just, there's no way you can be mentally stable in that frame of mind. Everyone knows who you are. Everything that you do is a viral moment. So all your mistakes and all your perfections are going to be highlighted in the public, whether it's good or bad. If we start off with the first episode, McGregor versus Khabib. In all honesty, I think McGregor, or at least the docuseries, showed McGregor paying somewhat respect to Khabib. You know, they didn't try and be biased in one side. They didn't try and make it out as if everything that Conor was doing was excused. He literally had his team members even openly saying, you know, they didn't like how it was. They didn't like the training. They didn't like how angry and vicious it was. They didn't know. And when he lost as well, I think it was Dolby, one of his coaches that was narrating over the show. He even said that he deserved it. After, you know, the horrible, well, I say horrible. It was a fucking exciting build-up to watch as a fan. It was the biggest fight in UFC history, McGregor versus Khabib. And obviously, you can't fault Khabib. He did everything that he needed to do. He came out and won. And I thought what was really interesting was, after all the shit that happened in the cage and everyone jumping in, it goes to the back and Conor's saying, you know, it was handbags. You know, I lost when it mattered and that's all that matters. And I think that just goes to show where he is with his respect with Khabib. You know, and it's funny because the whole Khabib beef was literally all built off of Artem Lobov, who has now turned into be a rat to McGregor, essentially. He's tried to take money off of McGregor, and now him and McGregor don't like each other at all. They're not friends. They used to be best friends. And then Artem Lobov's turned his back on him just to try and make some money, and it's ended up going sour. So it's funny that that whole beef between Khabib and McGregor was all started by someone who's not even friends with Conor anymore. So I don't know what the future holds for both of them, but I think, I mean, I'd like to see them show a bit of respect to each other now that the fights are done. You know, they're never going to fight each other ever again, I don't think, at least. So it'd be nice to see them have a handshake and, you know, even though there was so much bad shit that was talked about each other's families, the respect has to be there between each other. They were both a part of the biggest fight in UFC history, so it was an incredible docuseries. I think I wanted to see a bit more, I think. Like, if you compare it to the Notorious film, you got to see a lot more about his personality and a lot more of him talking about stuff, whereas there was a lot of old footage that was used for this. There was a lot of, like, old interviews. They kind of teed up for McGregor to have a sit-down interview right at the beginning, and then they didn't use any of it. So I'm not hating, you know. Now he's got his massive fight against Michael Chandler. The Ultimate Fighter airs next week, I believe. I think it's a week today, the 29th, so maybe, yeah, about a week today. And fucking hell, I'm so gassed. That's a massive fight for McGregor. That's a massive fight for Michael Chandler, but there's definitely more on the plate for Conor. Conor needs to come back and win this fight. And, you know, we all know he's done what he's needed to do to recover from his leg injury. I have no problem with fighters. You know, when they have a horrible injury like that, like the Chris Weidmans, the Anderson Silvers, the McGregors, when you have an injury like that, if you need to go outside of the testing pool to take medication to heal your leg properly that isn't allowed by USADA, by all means, I have no problem with doing that. So he's obviously now got to do 6 months in the testing pool before he can come back and compete, which I think gives him enough time to prepare for Chandler. He seems obsessed with this fight. He seems obsessed with his return. You know, the docuseries showed how active he wanted to stay. So I think he knows how important this fight is for his career, and he knows he needs to win this fight. So end of the year, MSG, 30 years, I think it's just written in the stars for that fight to happen over there. So, you know, it's obviously too early to call for a prediction, but based on recency bias and just based on the fact that I'm a massive Conor McGregor fan, my chips are definitely going on Conor McGregor, I think. And we all know, you know, Chandler is an unbelievable fighters, so exciting, leaves it all out there. But we all know someone's getting knocked out, and right now, I'd say it's going to go for McGregor. UFC Fight Night, Mackenzie Dern against Angela Hill. What an unbelievable card this was. It's amazing how good the UFC are at putting on cards, because half of these casual MMA fans probably wouldn't have been bothered watching that fight because they just thought, oh, well, it's a UFC Fight Night. There's not really that many big names on there, so there's probably not going to be any fights. But all the fights on the card were just absolutely ridiculous. Unbelievable finishes from top to bottom. Great fights that went the distance. And it just goes to show, I was comparing this to boxing last night. We had the Katie Taylor fight, which, unbelievable fight as well, by the way. That Cameron is an absolute beast to do what she did to Katie Taylor. But you never, ever see a boxing card with no big names, that's just a fight night, that's not pay-per-view, with finishes like that and with fights like that. You just don't get to see it at all. It's just a testament to the UFC, how great they are. I know people like to hate on the UFC for whatever reason, but no one does it better than the UFC. I can't stress that enough. Mackenzie Dern looked incredible against Angela Hill. 5-round war. You know, Mackenzie Dern, that's a great fight. She called out Rose Namajunas after that, and I think that'd be a great fight. I don't think Rose has fought since she lost her belt. And I'd like to see her come back. And I think Mackenzie Dern, that's a great fight to come back to. You know, Rose has got all the tools to beat her, but so does Mackenzie. So that makes for a great fight. There were a couple of ridiculous finishes that we must talk about. Joaquin Buckley, unbelievable head kick. All credit to Buckley. I mean, he is just, he's never in a boring fight. Even when he loses, he's in a good fight. Everyone knows his spectacular spinning kick knockout that is arguably one of the greatest knockouts in UFC history. And to come to 170, to make his debut at 170, new weight class, it could not have got better for him. And I'm excited to see what he can do at welterweight. You know who would be a good fight? I know they fought a middleweight, but I'd like to see him fight Holland again at welterweight. That'd be a sick fight. But for me, the knockout of the night by a mile was Ferreira. I think I'm saying his name right. Ferreira. his knockout of Michael Johnson. I mean, wow. Wow. He put him to sleep stiff. His curls were told, like, oh. I love knockouts like that, but mate, they just make you fucking just squeal a little bit when you see him, because that was a bad knockout. That's a massive loss for Michael Johnson at the stage of his career that he's at. You know, he's been in there with the best. He's fought the best, mate. He's knocked out Dustin Poirier. It doesn't get better than knocking out Dustin Poirier. That is an incredible win to have on your record. You know, he's fought the best of the best. He's fought Khabib, even though he lost, did well. So Michael Johnson's been around the game for a long time. So for Ferreira to come off, he was on a losing streak and now he's come back. You know, to do that to Michael Johnson, when he even said himself he was planning to try to take him to the ground, the ground game wasn't working, so I thought, fuck it, let's just stand and let's just work on the feet. And boy, did he make a statement. 50 G's for Ferreira. And yeah, unbelievable. Now, the last thing I want to touch on is Aljamain Sterling, the new bantamweight king. I say the new bantamweight king. He's been bantamweight king for a while now. And it was nice to see him actually get the respect that he deserves for beating Henry. Aljo's had some bad luck, obviously. You know, people have not seen how great he is until this fight, which is a bit of a shame, to be honest, because he deserves all the credit. You look at his resume, what he did to Corey Sandhagen. Okay, they had the DQ with Jan, which, by the way, was far from his fault. Like, there's no way you can say someone's acting when you get knee to the fucking head like that. I'd like to see any person who was saying that Aljo was acting take that knee after being in there for 20 minutes against Bian, take that knee and not react in that way. But anyway, then comes back, proves that he's good enough to beat Jan. And that win, by the way, against Jan, I personally think left a hole in Jan. If you look at, Jan was the boogeyman of the bantamweight. Someone was saying no one was going to beat him, he's going to stay champ for a while. Aljo comes along, beats him fair and square, and then I think he just loses it. I just think mentally, Peter Yan has lost himself a little bit since that Aljo fight. He's then gone and fought Sean O'Malley, lost a close fight to Sean O'Malley, and then Murad came and absolutely ragdolled him for 25 minutes. So Aljo was the king for a reason. He came back and beat TJ. Obviously, TJ had his injury, but nothing to take away. You know, mate, Aljo had a torn bicep, for fuck's sake. You know, they were both injured going into that fight. It wasn't just that TJ was injured. And then to come back, Henry Cejudo, 3 years off, looked incredible for 3 years off. I didn't think he'd look that good, personally. I thought Aljo was going to finish him. But to beat someone with that stature, you know, Olympic gold medalist, two-way UFC world champion, it doesn't get better than beating Henry. And Henry is so smart. He reads everything so well. It was an unbelievable chess match, and Aljo deservedly won. And I do think, you know, he is one of the greatest bantamweights of all time, without a doubt. And I think if he can go and beat Sean O'Malley, there is no more question. I mean, you could arguably say that he's already the greatest bantamweight of all time. And I don't disagree. I'm here for that argument. I'm not trying to say that he's not. But I think if he goes and beats Sean O'Malley, and he has the potential to really humble Sean O'Malley. Sean O'Malley is an unbelievable fighter. I love the guy. He's sick. He's unbelievable at his striking. He just seems like a geezer. You know, everyone likes Sean O'Malley. He seems like a sound guy, sick fighter. But everyone knows he's got a hole in his game. His ground game is just not anywhere near the ground game or the wrestling of Aljo. And Aljo, you know, his striking's not that bad either. His striking's very awkward and unorthodox, which makes him dangerous. So it's still a challenge for Sean O'Malley. I think this fight versus Sean O'Malley is arguably the biggest bantamweight fight of all time. I mean, obviously we had TJ and Cody. They were massive fights, but the run that Aljo's on and Sean O'Malley posed to be the next big star of the UFC, kind of the next Conor McGregor, if you like. I mean, no one's ever going to be like Conor McGregor, but you know what I mean? It's the same. He's the same type of superstar level that people are seeing him going down a route of. So this is a huge fight, a massive fight. And I just think Aljo has all the skills required to beat Sean O'Malley. The way I see this fight going, personally, I can see it being really close in the first few rounds. I can see Sean giving it all he's got to try and finish Aljo. I can see Aljo just staying there, biting down on his gum shield, taking the shots, getting a few takedowns. But I can just see, you know, Aljo just wearing him down. And I can see fourth round, Aljo taking his back, getting the choke. And that's all she wrote. And then Aljo moves up to featherweight. So that's my prediction. Obviously, no disrespect to Sean O'Malley. Like I said, I'm a massive fan of him. But I just can't see him beating Aljo in this fight, unfortunately. So that's the Monday MMA show. This is something that I'm going to be doing every Monday, as it's quite fucking obvious, the Monday MMA show. But like I said in my announcement video, I kind of wanted to do this just once a week, just to give you guys some extra specific MMA content, because I love doing MMA podcasts with fighters, but I am going to start doing loads of other podcasts without fighters. So I want to make sure that I still have content for you guys that is MMA related. So if you have enjoyed this video, make sure you like it. If you aren't following, make sure you subscribe. Make sure you follow me on Instagram and TikTok. And I'll see you with the next podcast or next week with the Monday MMA show. Peace.